Hi, Miss Coffee Bean and I would like to discuss something with you. Natural language understanding benchmarking, or NLU benchmarking in short. Why should we care? You can have the best machine learning algorithm in the world, but if your data is crap, your model won't be much better. And since our goal is to achieve natural language understanding, is it though? Yes, of course it is. How else should my smart fridge ever truly understand me? So, because we want to achieve NLU, we also need ways to measure how far we are getting there. But according to this position paper, NLU benchmarking is broken. So, in this video, we are going to discuss how NLU benchmarking is conducted nowadays, why it is broken, and what this paper proposes to do about this. Of course, all of this is sprinkled with a little bit of Miss Coffee Bean's opinion here and there. We will try to make it clear where this is the case. NLU benchmarking. Why is this even a thing? Don't laugh, but the way researchers measure progress towards machine learning systems that can understand natural language is through tests and benchmarks. It's school all over again, but now the machine learning models are writing the test. I don't know why this procedure is so hilarious to Miss Coffee Bean. Come on, Miss Coffee Bean, how else should we go on about it? We need to measure, to quantify, and write all of it down. I mean, imagine a tree in a forest growing so big that it achieved NLU. Did it even achieve NLU if there was no scientist to measure it and write a paper about it? Of course not, so here we are at the starting point of this paper, at tests and benchmarks containing a lot of examples that the model should get right to achieve NLU. Collections of data examples, or in short, benchmark datasets, can be something like superglue, containing data from various tasks that challenge these models. To give you one example, let's take the word in context subpart of superglue, probing for word sense disambiguation. Here the model reads in two sentences and must decide whether a word used in both sentences has the same sense or not. In this example, bed has a different meaning in the two sentences. Of course, there are many other tasks like reading comprehension, which is also probed by the Squad 2 English reading comprehension leaderboard, if you have heard of it. Anyway, the point here is that guess what? Biased models that are not at all at NLU level are able to solve these benchmarks. Now, we won't get into the philosophical rabbit hole of asking who decides that these systems are biased and are not at the level of NLU, although they solve the examples probing for NLU even better than humans. Because it's a sensitive area where goalposts are either moved a lot or people themselves have different opinions on where the goalpost even is. But let's formulate the general consensus like this. Although the models solve these NLU benchmarks in particular, they do not seem capable of NLU in general. They possess the biases specifically required for these benchmarks, but not for other things. In other words, these models don't solve the task. They only solve the datasets. Taken from yet another angle, they solve the examples for the wrong reasons.
What are the right reasons?
Miss Coffee Bean, quiet, that's complicated. Maybe something for another video. Anyway, to counter the problems of usual benchmarks, where models are exploiting dataset biases and spurious correlations left in there, like when an answer is correlated with a specific word, benchmarks like DynaBench are going away from the classical IID benchmark and goes into adversarial mode by asking human annotators to try to fool neural models, or at least a reference neural model. But as the authors of this paper highlight, adversarially constructed benchmarks will produce challenging examples. I mean, they are built specifically such that the models are set up to fail. But they also argue that this again doesn't help to produce a better way of benchmarking NLU, because these examples can be circumvented by producing models that drop one set of the bad reasons it used to solve the task without understanding it, and just choose another set of bad reasons that are not targeted by the adversarial benchmark. So the point here is that usual benchmarks are broken because of biases, that adversarial benchmarks do not solve the problem either, so the authors propose four new criteria that benchmarks should satisfy. Let's see what these four criteria are. We cite benchmarks should offer a valid test of the full set of relevant language phenomena.
Oh god, what does this even mean?
They should be built around consistently labeled
data. Miss Coffee Bean, explain.
They should offer adequate statistical power.
I don't get it.
And they should disincentivize the use of systems with potentially harmful biases.
Oh god, let's take it slow and see how the authors break up each of these points into digestible pieces.
The first criterion is the validity of the test. This means that if system A scores higher than the system B, then A should be better at the task it was tested at. Of course, this criterion will be violated by a system B exploiting biases in the dataset. The authors go on arguing how naturally occurring examples, think about data samples scraped from the internet, are not guaranteeing validity since natural distributions reflect the biases in the wild, but they also won't necessarily tickle out the relevant abilities for language comprehension from the model, because answers can be achieved also through factual knowledge rather than understanding. Just imagine a reading comprehension task where the model must extract who the president of the United States is from a text. Well, it does not need to if it has memorized this fact. Okay, Miss Coffee Bean, but surely examples generated by experts should do the trick, right? No. What do you mean, no? Well, expert-authored examples have problems, too. They are expensive, that's sure, but experts are human too and will introduce their own selection bias of phenomena they are studying, for example. So expert annotation does not guarantee broad testing coverage for model abilities either. Okay, Miss Coffee Bean, what else is there in the paper? Lastly, crowdsourcing, where random people on the internet construct data. There is no surprise, I guess, that it is broken too, because annotators are conserving energy, which is just the physicist's way of saying lazy. Therefore, they are generating repetitive, easy cases. I can speak from my own experience here. I worked with the visual dialogue dataset, where crowd workers had to create a dialogue given an image and its caption. By going through the examples, it is clear how uninspired some annotators were, since too many examples just talk about the picture in general and ask if that is in color or not, instead of focusing more on what is happening in the image, which would have been the desired annotation. Okay, so what would the perfect test set look like if it were valid? Well, the authors do not really propose the solution, otherwise this wouldn't be a position paper, but a paper presenting the dataset implementing this solution, right? But they survey some promising directions where crowdsourcing is combined with expert annotations, so where experts are filling in the gaps that laymen could not fill, or by offering bonuses to crowd workers when they avoid overused words and constructions. Well, and if everything about the first criterion isn't going so well, wait until you see the second criterion of reliable annotation. How many times have you gone through your data and saw wrong labels? Well, this is either due to careless mislabeling or just because the annotation guidelines were unclear or underspecified.
Oh, I know that one.
Or annotators themselves cannot agree on one single label. And if the benchmark has such errors, we can see the effect of superhuman performance on benchmarks. While one human only tries to solve the task with his own judgment that might not reflect the judgment of other annotators, models can pick up the patterns of the most frequent judgments, and herewith they surpass any single human annotator. The solution to this is careful planning and testing of annotation guidelines, or not compressing three annotations into one, but keeping the annotation distribution there to analyze how this fits with the prediction distribution of the model. Cool! The third criterion is about the benchmark's statistical power. The size of the data should be large and discriminative enough such that differences between two models' quality can be significantly detected. Fulfilling this is becoming harder and harder as the models get better because models start solving all easy examples correctly. And when easy examples make up most of the data, models start to differ only in the long tail, containing only few samples and not delivering statistical significance. The solution? It's simple, get more data. But well, the reality is expensive. Everything costs, especially when talking about more difficult data points. So we see how this becomes already a field of compromise.
The authors bring up the idea that maybe we can manage to formulate each data acquisition effort as a game where people buy playing annotate data for free. Isn't this a cool startup idea for anyone ethically okay with this? And the final and hardest criterion is about disincentivizing biased models. So we know that benchmarks are usually not bias-free. They are following natural distributions, which are biased, reflecting the world as is. Biased. Crowd-based source text is also biased, reflecting the annotator's bias. This is, of course, not news, but the problem of having these biases in the benchmark is that models have the incentive to be biased too. They aim to beat the benchmark, so they must have these biases too, otherwise it would get examples wrong when applying political correctness to them. This is, of course, a huge Pandora box of trouble and asks for further research, because there is no one-size-fits-all solution for mitigating bias. This is not a compelling reason to accept the status quo, write the authors. Point taken. An idea of going on about this is to create, we cite, additional expert-constructed test data sets and metrics that each isolate and measure a specific type of bias next to a primary task that the model is evaluated on. For me personally, it was surprising to read that, we cite, even for the superglue benchmark, which requires users to compute test set metrics on the DNC Vino gender test set in order to reveal test set results for any other target task. A large majority of papers that report test set numbers omit this metric and decline to report potentially unflattering bias numbers. Wow, this depends so much on the mindset of the community. What, you cynical Miss Coffee Bean, you're not surprised, eh? It's time to conclude this. What have we learned from this paper? That data, the heart and brains of our models, is important, but very hard to get it right. Happily, a maturity in the field of machine learning is developing, where we move just from model quality to data quality. It's best reflected in Hugging Face, where next to their model hub, they also work on their datasets hub. And no, they are not at all involved in us saying this, we are generally excited. The sad but also thrilling lesson from this paper is that clearly more research is needed on this dataset domain. If you think that you are more into data creation and model fiddling is not for you, go ahead and make cool progress for datasets. It is a cool place just waiting for more smart people to work in. Ms. Coffee Bean hopes that the benchmark creation field will become as sexy as the new model architectures like GANs, transformer versions, etc. in machine learning. Hope we're getting there soon. Thanks for watching until the end. Ms. Coffee Bean will let herself out.